I'm going to be installing current stable version of Debian on VirtualBox right now. So far I've been interrupted by everything under the sun, so this is the sixth or so take. I'm going to do a network install, though you can also use CD images for offline installs. It works very much the same way, you just boot off of CD1 instead of the net install CD, and it'll prompt you for the additional disks when it goes to install the software. We're going to do a net install, so select the appropriate architecture, i386 or AMD64. If you don't know or don't care, do i386 because it's more compatible. I'm going to do AMD64 because I know my stuff supports it. And I already downloaded it, so I'm going to proceed. New, give it a name, VirtualBox will decide you're typing Debian and automatically select that, which is kind of neat. I'll leave it at dev, give it some RAM, that really doesn't need all that much to just run. Virtual hard drive, give it a VDI because there's no real advantage to the others in this situation. Dynamically allocated, give it some additional space just because it's not going to take that up immediately. Though as the guest operating system allocates space, it doesn't automatically free space when you delete files because of the data still remaining on the disk when you unlink a file. Create creates the virtual machine in the inventory, go start, prompt you for a CD, and browse for your CD, pick the net install image you just downloaded or whatever install image you had selected, it goes start, and it'll boot from the CD and give you a few options. If for some reason you don't feel like going through the text-based install, do the graphical install. It looks nicer and supports the mouse. They're functionally very close to being identical, if not completely identical, in terms of what they can do. We'll go with the graphical install for now because it looks nicer. And switch to scaled mode, so use more of the screen real estate here. No. Do not like aspect ratio distortion. Pick your language, keyboard layout, and our location and keyboard layout by what you actually need. That loads the installer environment off of the CD initially, and goes to net install. It proceeds to configure networking, attempts DHCP automatically. So if it succeeds at that, I don't have to do anything else to get it connected to the internet to download its packages when it goes to actually install. Give it a name. I'm going to name it Deb because I named the VM Deb. You can give it a domain name, but there's usually not a need or reason to do that. Your normal testing purposes, unless you're setting it up as a server on the internet. Give it a root password. If you actually plan on using it, make it something reasonably secure. Mine is A in this case, just the letter A. It's easy to type. Make user, Bob. The second prompt is for the actual username as opposed to the display name of the user. Give him a password B. Proceed, set your time zone. Go with guided, use entire disk unless you know you have some reason to use a a fancy partitioning scheme if you have other disks you're trying to associate with the install or something. Go with all files in one partition, unless you have some reason to do otherwise. There's no real advantage to it if you're just testing stuff. You finish partitioning and write changes to disk selected, or make any changes that you want to the partitioning scheme. And select the disk, and you can hit continue on the disk, and it'll give you the settings, and you can do mount options like no A time, which disables access time updates, which can save a little bit of I/O time. It's usually not really that big of a deal. And rel A time is a reasonable option too. And you can reserve blocks. This option, when you go to look at it, it's basically the block size. I forget what each of these represents, but the large file options are very large blocks. I'm assuming, 1 meg and 4 meg per file. The default is the same as news, so 4k per block, which is pretty standard. And done setting up the partition. Continue. Swap space is the same as a Windows page file in essence, and I guess it's a Unix thing. That particular way of doing things makes more sense than putting the virtual memory expansion file on the partition itself, because it's just large and seemingly unnecessary file most of the time, so keeping it segregated, you don't have to worry about it. It's never in the way of anything. Finish partitioning, write changes to disk, and write changes to disk, and continue. Then makes said changes, and then it actually begins installing some rudimentary packages on the hard drive. And then this will let you select a list of mirrors for the actual package installation portion of it. And since I'm in the United States, it'll give me a list of relatively local mirrors to me. Unfortunately, mirror.anl.gov is going away. They're going non-public, so if you've been using them as a open source mirror, you'll need to move along, or I don't know if I don't think they're going to any sort of subscription model. I think it's for explicitly for internal use of the Argonne National Laboratory now, or at the beginning of February of this year, so not very long from now that'll be going away. So we're just going to go with ftp.us.debian.org because it I don't recall if it's a auto selector or if it's actually a specific server, but it usually works plenty well. Proxy if you need it, if you're behind a proxy. Downloads the package lists from the mirror. That way it'll know what software it has available to actually do the install. Now's a good time for me to hook up my external hard drive so I can maybe find something to do for entertainment and silence fill while the actual install happens. This appears to be taking a long time, so we're going to cancel and wait for it. Actually, I guess I could check here. Yeah, that hasn't. That is taking a little while. That's unusual. It probably selected a bad mirror. Go back. Rerun, configure the package manager, United States, just to avoid further issue, pick mirrors.kernel.org. They're usually reasonably reliable. As you can see, it's reading in the package list that it's getting from the mirror. Now it finally is. I guess it picked a bad mirror, hit it at an abnormally busy time, and lost the connection. And there really aren't a lot of minor oopses that you can't recover from during the install, and that's probably one of the more common ones with the net install, is that the mirror has a hiccup. And now it's downloading and installing a basic utilities and software that the very most rudimentary system would require. Actually, some of that looks like stuff that would be expected of a more complete setup, so I actually don't know what it's going for there. If you hold Alt F4, you can go to this log that I'm showing here. Alt F1, Alt F2, Alt F3, Alt F4, Alt F5 is the installer's virtual terminal. 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. There's only stuff on the first five. There it goes. And I don't usually participate in the package survey, but you can if you want. And just leave these defaults checked. I usually enable SSH server. We don't need laptop. Even though I am on a laptop that's running in a virtual machine, so it'll be fine, but I suppose it was able to detect some of the flags that suggest it's a laptop from within the virtual machine, which is interesting. So even if you're on a desktop, you might still consider including laptop, because it'll install additional ACPI utilities and things like that. So, and install a Windows compatible file server. Uses Samba or SMBFS or CIFS or something for file sharing with Windows. I believe it's the Apache 2 web server, MySQL. I don't remember which DNS server it comes with, Samba, and I don't remember what mail server this uses, but you can install those on the fly here. Print server you'll need if you plan on printing, because it uses a local print server to service all printing. Without that, I don't think you'll have a good time trying to get anything to print. And this appears to be going much faster than my last attempt at installing. I doubt that time remaining is actually accurate. I think it'll take a little bit longer than 4 minutes to download everything, but I could be pleasantly surprised, as my internet is reasonably fast. As this takes a little while to do, I found something I can do for crude form of entertainment. See if I can run the Windows 7 Minesweeper out of my portable hard drive, or if that's going to crash outright. I was expecting this part to take longer, but it seems to actually be moving along fairly quickly. Mm, unlike older versions of the Windows games, it doesn't look like I guess that was a lot faster than I expected it to be. And now it actually has to install the software, so that'll take a minute or two in itself, several minutes. Still trying to find something even remotely entertaining to occupy time here. Or since this is a functional Debian installation too, this will boot up for the heck of it. Just have something to do. The installations are long and boring. It'd be nice if they threw a game in there or something. Stupid small terminal. Getting in the way of my games. it. I guess that last one was a port of a console game, not a console game. Do that with fewer animals. Alrighty then, you want to install grub to the master boot record, most likely. The other option I think is to install it to the partition itself, but here it makes most sense to install it to the master boot record. Done. Continue, and it'll wrap it up, unmount all the disks, and reboot itself. And you'll note that it's booted from the grub bootloader instead of from the CD and proceeding now to boot. It doesn't look exceptionally pretty because it doesn't have a splash screen by default like all the other, say, desktop-oriented Linux installations. And as it did gripe, the limitation of the graphics hardware emulation here, I guess. But let's see. First thing I usually do when I get into one of these is start a terminal, switch to root, again with proper password, and do it again with the actual proper password, update the package manager's package list even though they're probably already up to date, install Synaptic, is already installed, it runs Synaptic, has to be run as root otherwise it won't be able to do what it does, and introduction to Synaptic, and I usually do this from the command line, but Synaptic is a nice graphical package manager. Since we're after XFCE, it'll automatically resolve the dependencies for it and thumb through the list of things and see if there's anything else that you want. It has its own terminal program. XFCE4 is just another window manager, or desktop environment rather. And click apply. You can also search by, you can search descriptions and titles up at the top, so it's useful for finding new and interesting software to mess around with, and it'll automatically download it from the repositories that you had specified during the installation. Close out of that, that can go away. Look around here, it comes pre-installed with a fair amount of software. Does it actually install? Yeah, it installs LibreOffice by default. That's probably a large chunk of the installation size. Several hundred megabytes of Office software all to itself. That's another thing I wanted to check is default install. Holding down Alt and holding a window will let you drag it around, and in other windowing environments, holding down Alt and right-click dragging will let you resize a window without having to grab the edge, as you'll see in a minute. And that's that. It's only 3.9 gig, the default install. Close that. Log out Bob. Bob, XFCE session instead, login, just use the default config for the panel, and XFCE, I have a slight preference to it over GNOME. Oh, nice. Taken to doing things from the command prompt most of the time, so I might stumble here sometimes. Or if you wanted to install the KDE desktop environment, the package management's kind of obnoxious to work with here. when you're looking for main packages. There's a bunch of different things that I could select that would automatically install everything that it needed to be able to use KDE. We're going to make the assumption that KDE full is the full install of KDE and select it accordingly, hit apply, and wait a moment. For several moments. Because KDE is absolutely enormous. That's actually going to take longer than I care to wait, so we shall look around here. XFCE 4 comes with its own terminal emulator that has it's a bit fancier than the X term I was using on the last one. The GNOME has its own terminal, gnome-terminal, that is perfectly fine. It has its own menu for that stuff. Alt F2 gives you a run box. And, typing from an awkward angle is always fun. GNOME terminal. It gave me GNOME terminal. Is this still GNOME terminal? Yeah, that's not XFCE's terminal. Something wrong here. It's not giving me a prompt. It's being the derps. XFCE has a pretty decent amount of configurability too. Not sure what's up with GNOME terminal there. UX term is Unicode X-Terminal. Alt right clicking and dragging here allows you to resize the window, which I've become very used to, which is why I was slopping around on the other console and the other desktop environment, which is GNOME, which I used to be a fan of GNOME many years ago. I still like it because it's a bit lighter than KDE, actually by a pretty substantial margin. It still is, but it just kind of fell away from it. These days I usually use actually Fluxbox. Comes with some games by default. As usual, I'm dead because I'm not very good at robots. now it's easy to... Yeah, I guess I've installed the KDM display manager along with it. Let me switch to that for the heck of it. Still not sure what is up with this. And Minesweeper variant or clone with slight graphical bugs. Okay, for some reason there. Okay, I got bugged to death. Or graphically glitched to death. Somehow. Wow, safe clicks dried up pretty quick there. It was definitely not a safe click. A little bit much in the way of graphical bugs for me. You can see all the KDE crap is coming into place. Comes with an assortment of media players, which is usually enough to get one by. CD burning utility. Let's see what this does. And it's gnome-terminal, which is broken outside of gnome, maybe? Screensavers. Like screensaver usually comes with a lot of interesting stuff to look at. Unfortunately, the 3D stuff is probably going to perform like total trash through the here if it's in a virtual machine. A little bit slow. it's not going to perform very well. Such frame rates. Control C, or your host key in C, breaks out of scaled mode if you're in scaled mode. And since this already has some of the VirtualBox extensions enabled, it automatically resize the display, which is also nice. You can expect much better performance on a reasonable desktop than on a laptop. Stuff's still coming in because all the KDE packages are still being installed. This may or may not work right. My white or black? I'm black. And I guess I let it take a corner, which is not good. Because then it can just keep killing me from the outside. I don't lose by too much. And it'll reprocess the menu eventually, and the icons should show up eventually in other desktop environments. Some of the software names are pretty self-explanatory. Some of them are just rather odd. But there's a pretty broad variety of stuff. Yeah, another reverse clone. Othello, or whatever it's originally called.
Why would I not want a grid? Computer throwing a hissy fit. Or maybe it's being bogged down by background tasks. And that AI felt like it was harder for some reason that I did better. So I don't know. Okay, done. Log out, either way. Here we're actually going to kill the machine. And save it, but we want to SIM shutdown signal, it should shut itself down cleanly. Wait until it goes away. Display. Ah, it's the wrong one. Display. A lot more video memory. Enable 3D acceleration. Enable 2D acceleration. I don't know why it says it's invalid. Because now it doesn't, it doesn't allow for 2D on Linux, I guess, I don't know. Yeah, it does that, I never figured out exactly why, I'm sure somebody knows. Screen mode on the wrong display. There we go. And this is KDM instead. Not like that doesn't show what you're selecting. Definitely a fairly advanced desktop environment. It's got a lot to do. All the games that were installed, all the KDE applications usually start with the letter K, though It's not to say that they can't be, or that all applications that start with K are going to wind up being KDE applications. But, in general, that's, I've always enjoyed it. Supports compositing in its configuration that it comes in here. Comes with a web browser that I usually use IceWeasel or Firefox, which IceWeasel is a Firefox fork that strips all the Firefox branding to avoid that copyright issue. And I don't know if you can see the flickering mouse cursor, but it is definitely flickering. The performance of Conqueror, the web browser, is pretty decent. The compositing all seems to work properly. If I had had 3D support enabled, I believe that the screensaver would have worked a lot nicer. Where is screensaver settings here? Desktop effect. So this is all the fancy things that you can apply to it. Screensaver. Much better layout of stuff than X Screensaver demo. No, I guess it's still in trash performance mode. It's simple stuff is going to work just fine. Also sure that if I wasn't running at 1920 by 1080, it would probably perform just a little bit better. Negligibly, not usefully better. So probably don't want to try to do anything fancy OpenGL stuff on this without getting 3D acceleration set up properly. Yes, Dolphin is currently their file browser. I think they used to use Conqueror as their file browser in addition to their web browser. Not sure exactly when they dropped that, because I haven't really, this is actually my first time poking around at KDE in a while. It works kind of like Finder on a Mac or something. I do not think that Yeah, that doesn't really suggest any significant hardware acceleration. That's that.